going to play around, and I'm going to throw down my money, and I'm going to double my money, and I'm going to walk out. And that just feels so right.
Or you, well, okay, I thought you were going to end it with, then you stand up and shoot everyone at the table and take their money.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Doc, and Chris try to differentiate between minigames and games within games, and talk about some of their favorites. Plus, Sonic Mania, Yakuza Kiwami, PlayStation 5 rumors, and more. Backward-Compatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode number 109 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast, games and new media with a splash of academia. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hello.
And we're joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And our media topic of discussion for today,
we're going to talk about games within games and mini-games within games.
Mini-games within games within games?
Activities that you can do within games that are not necessarily the main game, but they are other aspects that you might enjoy sometimes more than the game itself.
Or they could become their own spin-off game, as we've seen in a few cases.
So many mini games.
I'm still waiting on professional blitzball to become a thing. So I'm ready. I'm in it. That's an e-sport I can get behind.
Cool. But first, we have some opening segments for you, including the button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
A couple days ago, a game came out that was kind of been interested in a while, really, the series, the Yakuza series, which is a Sega game series that I've never actually played before, but I heard it was sort of an open world, almost like a GTA style game, but made by a Japanese developer and set in Japan. Obviously, the Yakuza are a different collection of different gangster families in Japan, so it seems like it would have similarities there, but actually, to me, a lot more similar to Shenmue. The game that I picked up was actually Yakuza Kiwami, which is a remake of the original Yakuza that came out in 2005 for the PS2. I'm actually enjoying this game quite a bit. It's basically the first three chapters, it's not open world at all. You're in a city, but a lot of the streets are closed off. You can't go down them. And it's basically setting the stage for the story to come. So essentially, without getting too deep into the story, because it actually has a lot of twists and turns. The whole first chapter, you are learning a little bit about your character and the relationships, and it starts out in 1995. And as the chapter closes, you essentially take the heat for the murder of a patriarch in the Yakuza, one of the Yakuza families. So because of that, you get sent to prison for 10 years. And in those 10 years, your fighting style, your fighting techniques essentially become blunted because you're not fighting in prison. The main reason for that, of course, is that if you want to get out of prison with a commuted sentence in only 10 years for murder, you're going to have to be a model prisoner, right? So that's how they explain that he got out of prison. But it also mixes in with the game mechanics, because it means that in that first early chapter, you had all of your abilities already, kind of like like a lot of the Metroid games, where you have all your abilities at the start.
Yeah, we talked about this a couple weeks ago.
And they take them away. And that's what happens here. So because you're in prison for 10 years, you're not fighting anybody. You lose all of your fighting prowess. And then when you come out, you now have to build it back up through different tech trees as you gain experience along the way. So it actually does it pretty cleverly. You have four different fighting styles that you can swap between instantly in battle. You have a rush style, which is a very quick punching, kicking style, almost like kind of a Bruce Lee type thing, where it's a lot of like dodging and rapid attack, but you can't do any grabs. You have a brawler style, which is like a city beat down, kind of a little bit of a balanced style, in that you're using bigger attacks, but you can still defend and dodge. You have one called, I can't remember the name of it, I think it's called Berserk, but it's essentially a style where you go berserk. You can't defend. You can grab, of course, but you can't really defend. And your defense is like nullified. So you're just kind of like standing there as almost like a big tank and trying to just beat the enemy down. And then the final style is your personal style called the dragon style, because you are known as the dragon of Dojima, which is your family.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, you have this, it's kind of this style where you can do a whole bunch of things that's really overpowered, but you have to unlock it through events in the game. And they have a lot of mini games in this one, similar to a GTA type and other open world games or a Shenmue. Some of them are little like crane games, you know, mahjong, bowling, batting cages. So it's kind of similar to what we're going to be talking about later with mini games. There's a lot of them in this game. No driving, from what I've seen so far. But it's much, and the game does open up after the third chapter too and becomes totally an open world game. But there's a lot of story elements and cutscenes in it, and they're short cutscenes, but there's a lot of like heavy story element, like factors to the game. And then all the open world stuff is almost like here's things you can do between story bits. So to me, that makes it feel not just like, okay, it's set in Japan, which is true, but it's also very much a Japanese game, because they are focusing on, which is something that I feel that I've noticed in Japanese, both anime and live action shows, which I watch. They have this kind of, you know, they like darker stories, but they also like melodrama.
Mm.
And when they're going to tell a story, this is the way they're going to tell that story. They're not going to have more of a subdued story that you might see in something like a GTA 5, where the story is almost like the set dressing to lure you into the world. This is kind of the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a very interesting game, and I recommend checking it out. Chris, have you been playing anything recently?
What
I say coyly.
What gives you that idea?
The Sonic cap that you have.
Ah, very observant. I'm glad you noticed. Yes.
I thought he just sprouted ears.
I've been playing Sonic Mania. It is a very, very good game. So it's kind of what you could sort of describe as a love letter to the original Genesis Sonic games 1, 2, and 3. It's developed by a team of mostly independent developers and artists and stuff like that.
Wait, it's not developed by Sega?
I think it's not directly, not okay. Like with an internal team necessarily. It's licensed
though. Yeah.
Yeah. So. And I think like Christian Whitehead's one of the big guys who's involved with that. I think he was one of the original programmers on the old, like the original Sonic games.
That sounds right.
And so he's kind of helped resurrect this. And what's kind of cool about it is that they're recycling, and this is something that actually kind of confused me when I first heard about it, because they were showing footage and I recognized a lot of levels from when I played it on the Genesis. And so I was thinking like, oh, maybe what it is they're taking like Sonic 1, 2, and 3, republishing those, and then also adding a few new levels, maybe even like a whole new game on top of it, and kind of having like a 4-pack. It's actually just one game. And the way that they do it is they... Yes, it's a 1-pack. they basically pull together some of like the most popular, most interesting levels from throughout the original trilogy. And then they remix them. And it's actually really cool how they do it, because it's not just, hey, here's this level you recognize. What they do is they actually have the first act be an amalgamation of all the most sort of memorable moments, the sort of iconic things that may or may not be exactly the same as they were before, but from both acts of that zone, from the original game. So like there are parts where if you're going through in this one act, I'm kind of recognizing both of the levels from the original. And then the second act, they actually come in with a whole new art style. Well, not a whole new, but they put some twists on the original formula to where there are like some new mechanics, some new look and feel, some new music, all this different stuff that it's a familiar level, but done in a totally new way.
Is it still throughout? Is it still the 2D sort of Super Nintendo Genesis look, like the 16-bit?
Yes.
It looks
gorgeous. I can't believe I defaulted to Super Nintendo. Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry, Sonic
fans.
Yeah. It's just because the Super Nintendo is the better console than the Genesis.
Well, you know, we all know that. Genesis does what Nintendo don't, so, I mean, take that as you will.
Make games that aren't as interesting.
Yeah.
Cut it out. Cut that. Cut it.
You're having flashbacks to the console wars of the 90s.
Uh-huh. So what you were saying, Chris, mm-hmm. it sounded like you were confirming then that none of our speedrun macros are going to work.
Probably not.
Oh, man.
Until you develop new ones.
Right.
Yeah. And what's kind of cool is that in addition to these remixed levels that I mentioned, they also have a few new levels. And so I'm pretty sure they did all the art again from scratch because they were making it HD compatible. So it's still scaled up pixel graphics, but it's built for widescreen. I definitely know all the character sprites are new.
Oh, cool. So these are sprites, too. It's not like it's a 2.5D where it's 3D models. It is definitely sprites.
It
looks like I remember it.
Mm-hmm.
And I have said this on the podcast before. My memory is in HD.
Right.
Even 8-bit graphics in my memory is HD because we had little 15 and 20 inch screens.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you blow those things up to the 50 inch screens that we have now, it feels wrong.
Yeah.
But whenever you let that resolution sort of scale with the scale, it makes sense to go HD with pixel graphics. So this is my thesis and my manifesto, and I'm sticking to it. But my point is this: it looks right.
Yeah,
I haven't played it.
Mm-hmm.
I was never a huge Sonic Mechanic fan. I just didn't have access to the system. I didn't have the system, but I had friends who did.
Mm-hmm.
And so, to me, I think they did a great job from what I've seen.
Oh yeah, it's really well done. It has some really interesting touches in there too. For example, speaking of the graphics, you can actually turn on a filter that simulates a CRT.
I love it when they do that.
So basically it adds like a little bit of a grid to it. And they can also, you can change the sharpness. So like there's CRT sharp and then CRT soft.
Mm-hmm.
Can you play as different characters?
Yes. And that's something I was about to get to, is that you can play as Sonic, Sonic and Tails, or as Knuckles. And you can also play as Tails solo.
But what about Big the Cat?
No, Big the Cat.
What?
Sorry.
The best Sonic character you can play.
You can't go fishing for Froggy in this one.
Which game was it that you were able to create your own character? That was a big deal.
That's Sonic Forces. And that's coming out this fall.
Okay, that's not out yet.
Mm-hmm.
Got it.
Yeah.
That one probably won't be as good.
Well, we'll see. It's going to be different for sure.
Is it safe to say that you are a Sonic maniac at this point?
You might be able to say that, okay. Perhaps.
You have Sonic Mania. You've caught Sonic Mania.
Yes.
Is there going to be a song coming out just like, when Pac-Man was big, we had Pac-Mania, the song.
Maybe.
Or we'd have Sonic Mania, the song.
Maybe.
Is it back to that level?
Well, speaking of songs, actually, I think they have a whole new soundtrack. Some of them, most of them are kind of remixes of the old tracks.
That's got
a new theme. Mm-hmm. The boss themes are totally different because and this is another thing that's really cool about it. I was mentioning that the levels feel like they did, but they're not the same. So it is like playing a whole new game. The bosses are all totally different, all new bosses, even for the same zones. They have some games within games. Some of them are remakes of the sort of ball puzzles, if you remember from Sonic 3.
Yes.
Those are how you unlock some of the special unlockables.
Mm-hmm.
One of which is very funny. It's called And Knuckles. And what it does is whoever you're playing as, including Knuckles, you get a Knuckles that follows you around, kind of like Tails follows Sonic. And in all cases, you can actually have a second player grab a controller and control that second character, which is just was in the Genesis.
Oh, yeah. That's really cool.
You can do Sonic and Knuckles, or you can do Knuckles and Knuckles, which is a little bit of a reference to, they have a lot of cool, sort of subtle self-referential things, references to internet jokes that have been going on. The Ann Knuckles thing is a big joke on the Sonic Twitter and stuff like that.
Hmm.
So, just overall, I would say that if you've never played Sonic, this is an excellent time to jump back in on it. If you used to like Sonic and got a little bit disillusioned, this is a great time to go back and sort of revisit. It's definitely a nostalgia trip, but it's a totally new game at the same time.
So what systems is it on?
I think pretty much everything. It's on Switch, which is where I have it.
So I can get it on my classic Game Boy.
No, sorry.
Oh, well, okay.
all current systems.
Okay, so like PS4, Xbox One,
probably.
Switch.
Yes. I can't confirm, okay. But I know that I have it on Switch.
Is it on any handheld consoles? Like, for example, 3DS?
It might be. I'm not sure.
Okay.
I'd have to look that up. It's only $20.
That was my second question.
Yeah.
So it's $20?
$20.
Okay. So both of our choices were newer games,
mm-hmm.
newer Sega games that are priced below the typical price point, mm-hmm. the modern price point of $60. It's nice.
It's time to hashtag get wrecked with some talk about competitive multiplayer games.
I always hesitate when I'm about to talk about Gwent because I don't know how much prep I need to talk about when I talk about Gwent. How much clarification do I need to do when I talk about Gwent? Which Gwent am I talking about when I talk about the Gwent that I am talking about or about to talk about? And the answer is, I'm about to talk about the open beta for the Gwent standalone game which is not to be confused with the closed beta for the Gwent standalone game, or the Gwent game, which was the in-game game, or if you prefer...
Game within a game?
Yeah, there you go.
Like we're talking about later.
Witcher 3.
Yeah.
Which was Jim's not game of the year game of the year.
I thought it was my game of the year.
Was it? I don't know. I don't listen to the podcast. the point is this. Gwent has undergone some interesting changes. It is experiencing a wonderful new life of its own. I'm very excited about it. I don't know that it's going to be a Hearthstone killer necessarily, but I think it has a good chance potentially to rival it, let's say.
Did you hear that Valve's trying to get on the action too, the card game spinoff?
Of?
Just card game spinoff. They're doing one for League of Legends, or no, Dota. Sorry, Dota.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, okay.
Wait, what?
So yeah, they have a Dota.
Valve hasn't made a game in like 50 years.
They're making a Dota card game spinoff. I think it's called Ark or something like that. And it was funny because they announced it, the Dota World Championships that happened recently. Mm-hmm. And it was mostly boos and groans they announced it.
Did anyone in the crowd just scream out, Half-Life 3?
Probably. I didn't hear it on the video that I saw.
It sounded like that. Their voice cracked as they're yelling it.
Yeah. Like there was like some polite applause, but mostly what you hear was just like, oh.
So, Portal sequel. No.
But anyway, not to distract too much from Gwent.
Well, you did.
You're welcome.
Way to go.
Thank you.
Here's my negative review before I talk good about it, okay? This is not the same Gwent. Fundamentally, at a core mechanic level, it's still the same Gwent. You've still got three rows. You're still playing cards. You're trying to get a higher score than your opponent within three rounds. Done. But so many things have changed on a fundamental mechanics level, like weather or the horn blowers or how the way that you can actually attack cards directly and reduce their values, that I would argue that there has been a little too much influence by other collectible card game, virtual Hearthstone style games. And I'm wondering if it is, if for the sake of the, let's call it the human versus human, right? The PvP element. I'm wondering if it has evolved a little too much. So, as an example, this last patch that came out, more of an update than a patch, was huge. It was all really great stuff. It was basically the social patch. There were 30 new cards, which was great. But it had friend matches available on consoles. It has in-game friends list on PC. The player profile is now sort of a public thing that's viewable. They changed the UI just a little bit in ways that needed to happen. But that's almost like, yeah, okay, we expected that. We're in beta, and we knew that was coming. The problem that I have overall whenever I look at this game is I recognize that within The Witcher 3, it's a single-player game. You can confirm this, Jim.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
I can as well.
Yeah, yes. There you go.
Single-player. So
whenever you think about it in terms of it being an in-game game, right, a mini-game, what you are really playing for is the card so that the next time you can add that to your deck and continue playing. And so in that sense, it's really almost like a story mode of sorts in this game. It's like a level that you're trying to beat. So now what we have is a real-time, live, person-versus-person, player-versus-player environment. And the card decks are being changed, and there's a meta, and there's all these things that didn't exist before. Whenever you went up against, you know, tavern owner Bob, and he had a certain deck or a certain card, you played the first time to learn how he played, then you tweaked your deck, and then you beat him. Mm-hmm. That's the way it worked in Witcher 3. Now, this is a completely different approach and a completely different mentality. What you're really trying to do is to develop a good deck and beat somebody. Hmm. So part of that is that in order to get new cards, you actually craft them. Now you can buy kegs, and kegs have cards, and they've done a neat thing, I think, where you get four cards at random, and then the fifth card, you get three that are random, and they're always a nice card, and you pick from the three.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
Yeah. So whichever one, so you don't take, you don't get those cards. So you have to make a real kind of critical decision. And it's a lot of fun. And I like that. But they've also replaced the tutorials that were in the closed beta with what they're calling challenges. And you could almost, I really hate to even say this, but the analog might be the adventure mode in Hearthstone. Mm. But it's really not, because the whole point of it is that you beat this challenge deck in sort of the old Witcher 3 mode and model. It never changes, right? Mm-hmm. Their deck that you're trying to beat never changes. And when you do that, whatever the leader is that's in that deck you're challenging, you win that card.
Okay.
I love single player mode of the new Gwent open beta. I think it's brilliant and I think it's fantastic. And it reminds me of Witcher 3. To that end, whenever I was in the closed beta, I got to level 10 very, very quickly. It was like in two play sessions. I
is
was
pretty is much 10 there. The max level?
No, 10 is actually whenever ranked play starts.
Oh, okay.
And I assume this is your player level. It's not like attached to classes as it is in Hearthstone.
Right. It's very different.
Yeah.
And so basically you can start in competitive mode, if you will, at that point. Well, now there's going to be a professional tier as well, which is kind of interesting. As of the 1st of September, there's now a professional tier in this most recent update. So they are really trying to look at this as a ranked, pro, competitive sport, mm-hmm. if you will. That's the way they want this to be. And anybody can get in and potentially be a part of that. So I think there's a lot of really great stuff going on with Gwent. It is not the game that it used to be. It is a different game. And I think that that's okay. Keep an eye on Gwent. I think it's going places.
Grab your salt shakers, because it's time for some reckless speculation. Our excuse to engage with rumors, hearsay, and all sorts of crazy theories.
So I'd also like to address, just because we are a gaming podcast, some gaming rumors, gaming speculation. But it's a little bit less reckless, because we do have some heavy hitters in the financial industry that are backing this speculation. It is still speculative at this point, and what I'm talking about is, as many of you may have already heard, if your finger is on the pulse of gaming news, the PlayStation 5 might come out as early as next year.
No.
Yes, and this is not coming from me. This is coming from Wall Street Journal, Forbes, a couple of other sites have reported this, and specifically they're citing various financial analysts who have essentially looked at it. They've looked at where Sony is now. They've looked at the sales of the PS4, which have been dropping. Even though Sony itself as a company is doing well, they have had some drooping sales. They look at how long the console has been out, and they say, okay, the time is ripe, especially with the excitement over the new Switch console that has just come out. They're saying that the time is right for a new PlayStation console. Mm. And they are speculating, and their job is basically to speculate about when these console releases might happen, or anything else for that matter, when it comes to new products that might hit the market. So to just out of hand dismiss their speculation as, oh, that's just their guess, I think would be foolhardy. I mean, this is their job. This is what they do. Mm. So I think there is some clout to what they're saying here. Of course, when I heard the news, my initial thought was, wow, this seems way too soon.
Yeah, that was kind of my initial.
I mean, what do y'all think about this?
Because, like, you know, you could look at Nintendo, for example, and they had a couple of pretty quick releases with the Wii U and with the Switch. But I think that's partially because the Wii U, because the Wii had a really nice long lifespan.
Right, right.
The Wii U wasn't quite as successful as they were hoping, and it had a good run, but I think they wanted to sort of end that quickly and get to the Switch.
I think that's an understatement. Mm-hmm. As much as I've enjoyed some of the games on the Wii U, and I think some of them are excellent games, mm-hmm. and Mario Maker, I still contend, is one of the best games of that generation. The Wii U was a failure as a console in terms of sales.
Yeah.
It really was.
Yeah.
I don't think there's really any denying that. And that's why I think they had to have a little bit of a quicker turnaround with mm-hmm. the Switch.
Yeah.
Is that kind of what you're thinking, too?
Yeah, and also, like, you know, I think it kind of makes sense, too, for Nintendo, because their upgrades typically aren't massive hardware upgrades. They're just, like, you know, the Wii U and the Switch are both more about the functionality. Like, the Wii U was an improvement over the Wii graphically, but it was more kind of catching up, or maybe even arguably just kind of, like, getting to an acceptable level by most people's standards, because it was more like, you know, kind of PS3, Xbox 360 plus. You know, it wasn't the same level as Xbox One, PS4. And the Switch also isn't trying to be a powerhouse. It's trying to sort of have its, for lack of a better term, gimmick. That is the thing that's selling it. Mm.
So my issue here with the PlayStation 5 and those rumors is that at first I said, okay, this is way too soon, mm-hmm. because that's my reaction. And then I started looking at the actual years in terms of when the release dates were, and it kind of checks out. I mean, I looked at the date, and the PlayStation 4 released in November of 2013. So there, this.
It's our official podcat.
So I looked it up, and the PlayStation 4 came out in November of 2013. And if these analysts are correct, they are speculating a fall or holiday release for in 2018, in next year, essentially,
so
for
the
PlayStation 5.
Five years.
Almost exactly 5 years. That is the same length of time between, for example, the Nintendo and the Super Nintendo. And we think of the Nintendo as this... the NES, the NES, as a powerhouse system that dominated the industry, which it did for a while. But it was only, you know, on market as the only console that Nintendo had out for 5 years.
Now,
from 1985, now, obviously, it came out in 83 in Japan.
I was about to say, yeah.
That may be true. However, they could have ridden that out longer, and they chose not to. And when it comes to the PS3 versus the PS2, and the PS2, I should point out, is the most successful console of all time. So the PS2 only had one extra year of space between the PS2 and the PS3, and that's for the most successful console ever.
For 6 years?
Yes. So to say that 5 years is too early just on a pure date standpoint, I think is incorrect. It clearly could happen, and yet it feels too early. And why do you think this is?
Because we're old men.
Well, I was going to say that part of it could just be our sort of perception of the passage of time.
I disagree, though, and I have an idea about this, and I think it's because even though there has been some good games on the PS4, of course, I'm not going to deny that there hasn't been. I mean, we talked about The Witcher 3, excellent game. I recently played Nier Automata, and it's one of my favorite games ever. I absolutely loved it this year. But it does feel like there are not that many iconic games on the PS4.
Yeah.
And it also feels, and in this generation in general, to be honest with you, and aside from a few obvious examples, and it also feels like there are a lot of remakes of other games.
A lot of remasters, yeah.
A lot of remasters and remakes. Like, for example, tons of them from the PS3, like The Last of Us remaster, remaster that. I am currently playing a remake from a PS2 game right now.
Yeah.
I'm enjoying it, but that to me says something when some of the bigger games on a system are remakes or remasters or sequels in a series that may not necessarily bring anything to the table. I'm looking at you, Uncharted 4.
Well, there's actually a new Uncharted that just came out recently as well.
That's the one I was talking about, Uncharted 4.
No, like, I think there's another new one.
That's Lost Legacy or something. Yeah, that's another good example of we're out of ideas. Like, why are you doing this? I saw the trailer for that. I'm like, guys, it's over. The series is done. You haven't done anything creative. Uncharted 4 had a few all right ideas in it, but there's nothing new there. I mean, the series has been treading water for a while. It's been going mainly off of the strengths of its graphics and sort of high production value of it, of storytelling is kind of what it goes on.
Yeah, well, Assassin's Creed Origins is going to change everything.
Oh God. So
I think another
thing,
there's
some truth to that in terms of just, may not be enough games.
I think that's a big one. And I think too, that, like, you know, you kind of expect early in a console's lifetime to have the few, like, kind of remasters, remakes to update the graphics. You saw the same thing with the PS3 era. But typically that's something that happens early and then sort of stops.
Right.
This has been happening constantly enough that it feels like we maybe are still supposed to be in the early phase.
It's consistent.
I think the other thing too is that they just had the release of the 4K versions of the consoles.
Right.
And so it almost feels like it's a whole new console, even though it's not. But I think that just kind of like they just came out with those, and now we're already talking about a whole new one.
Well, and also I think there's this issue of this new console, if they do come out with the PlayStation 5, it's going to be another one of these small steps, not the big leap.
Yeah.
The PS3 and the PS4 was a small step, not a big leap.
I think,
whereas the PS2 to PS3 was a big leap.
Yeah, and that's
the NES to the SNES was a big leap. So we're seeing these. It feels like the releases are about the same length of time, and yet we're not making big strides when it comes to processing power well, really, maybe we are in terms of raw power, but when it comes to how we're using it.
Yeah. And I think that's a big part of it too, because to an extent, when you have a big graphical update, you can sort of look to the PC as kind of here's what the new standard is, and it very quickly moves ahead
right.
of the consoles. But even with like the PC being more advanced, it's just, you know, like, hey, I can turn my stuff up to ultra. It's not really that different, you know, most of the games. So I think that either if they're going to come out with a new console in the next year or two, it's going to be like, let's just make it as powerful as the best gaming PCs and say that we can really compete with them on graphics. Or there have been some rumors going around that the PS5 might actually be a Switch-like system where they have like the sort of portable thing, the or the attachable controllers. There are a few people who sort of like leaked or supposedly leaked some concept art for that. Now, that could just be the typical, hey, there's a rumor that this could be the case. And so there's a concept artist who did a thing to say, here's what it would look like if they did it. Which
that's what I think.
It's usually wrong.
Right, because all that we've heard so far, at least, we've had not heard anything official from Sony. We've really just been hearing from analysts. Mm-hmm. So again, I'm not denying that what they say has merit, but and so we really haven't heard anything official. So to say, oh, it's going to be like this, mm-hmm. I think is way too premature. I also don't think that's the direction that Sony will go, because I think it's not where their moneymaker is.
Yeah.
Like both Sony and Microsoft are in a situation where they are selling what has become essentially a
entertainment
game,
hub.
Well, but a game dedicated PC. It's kind of what it is now. The consoles themselves are, like you said, they are entertainment systems too. They do other things like play video and stuff like mm-hmm. that, which I watch Netflix on my PS4. So they are, but they're basically like stripped down PCs. I mean, it's not like, for example, the Switch. It's not that. It is a gaming platform.
Mm-hmm. Dedicated would be a better word.
Right.
I mean, stripped down implies that there's stuff that's missing.
There is.
Well, there isn't.
From a PC. No. From what a PC can do.
In terms
versus
of
what?
In terms of functionality, I agree.
That's what I'm talking about.
But that's the thing, is that a console is not meant to do those things.
And that's
so whenever you right. dedicate the processor entirely to, for example, graphics, you don't need a top-of-the-line processor. It wouldn't do any good. We're not developing for that.
I think that's a different discussion, but that's also
a completely different
but
discussion.
That's also not true. The gaming PCs, when you use a better processor, output better graphics.
Well, yes, than they do. But the console, at the same time, it's an illusion that we are using all of our PC when we use it for gaming. There's layers that are happening in that. And one of those layers is the operating system.
Sure. But that really wasn't what I was talking about. I'm talking more about what you can do with the PC.
And I get it.
And I'm just saying that basically, instead of having a game console, we have a PC with less functionality.
Let me reframe it. About 10 years ago, I was standing in front of a classroom and I said, here is my prediction. Within the next year or two, we are going to hit the, I called it the plateau. And I cited as examples the original Assassin's Creed. You know, we're talking like
right.
Jerusalem, Assassin's Creed. And I said,
the best one.
Yeah, in many ways. And what I said was, in terms of graphics, in terms of sound, in terms of, you know, the ability to create visually what we want a thing to be, gameplay, all of that, we're going to reach this plateau where if you can write it in the game design document, we can make it. And it may take 400 people to do, and that was one of the revolutionary things about that game, is that they put 400 people to work on the game. Oh my goodness, that's crazy. It was beautiful. It had all of this wonderful design that went into it. But then there were some repeated elements, shall we say, and that was refined in later iterations of the game.
Right.
Because it got kind of boring and samey pretty fast. That said,
and then ironically, the series itself became a repeated element.
I know, right? but my point was this. We're going to get to a point, this was my argument 10 years ago, that we were very quickly going to get to a point where we could focus on gameplay and writing and telling stories and that kind of a thing, because the other stuff weren't really going to be limitations. And I think in many ways we've reached it. And this harkens back to a couple of weeks ago whenever we were talking about, you know, is it time to stop forgiving the
right.
developers? You know what I'm saying? When can we stop using "but it's a video game" as mm-hmm. an excuse?
No, I'm with you, and I think that we have reached that point. I think that we've reached that point a while ago,
yeah.
And I feel like
I would agree.
I feel like many developers, though, haven't caught on to that yet. They're still trying to sell their game based on mainly graphics and cinematics, which I think, and I'm not bashing cinematics, but I feel like that's not what you should be selling your game on.
I agree. So to tie all of that into the is it too soon for a PS5 question,
sure.
I think the answer is we have not seen the full potential of the PS4.
Mm-hmm. That is true.
And as a broad statement, that could mean a lot of things. I think that it can do more graphically than we've seen. I think it can do more in terms of gameplay and speed than we've seen. I think it can do more in terms of story than we've seen. I think there's a lot of things that the PS4 can do that we haven't seen.
I think we need to end this reckless speculation on more reckless speculation. Hmm. I think that what Doc is saying here is that, and you're calling it right now, if I'm understanding you correctly, coming soon to PlayStation 4, Metal Gear Solid 6. It's back. Thanks, Doc.
Yeah.
Pinnacle of gaming.
You're entirely welcome for that thing.
Pinnacle of gaming.
Either think or say.
So actually, this
official quote by Doc Brackett.
This does bring up a point, though, that I want to make where this doesn't happen with every game, but there are some games out there that are so ambitious in their scope mm-hmm. that it takes them a very long time to develop.
Yes.
And you end up with that thing. Final Fantasy 15 is a good example.
Yeah.
You know, you could argue that, like, you know, maybe it wasn't as good as it could have been, yada, yada, but it did take a very long time to make this game. It was supposed to come out. Yeah. It was supposed to come out on the PS3. It ended up coming out on the PS4.
Well, look at Cyberpunk. Was it mm-hmm. Cyberpunk 2044, I think it is, from mm-hmm. CD Projekt Red.
Yeah. And
they're having that issue right now.
Yeah. And so, yeah, you've got games like that with a very long development cycle.
Mm-hmm. Red Dead Redemption 2.
You're running the risk of coming out with another console before the game's ready. And then all of what you have is this whole sort of early part of a new console that's just kind of like slightly updated.
They do a rebuild
versions of the, previous
Gun
generation.
Ran into that. That's actually one of my favorite, all-time favorite Western games ever was Gun. Mm-hmm. Great classic Xbox game, but it also came out on the Xbox, whatever the next one was, 360. Mm-hmm. And the graphics were better. The game itself was exactly the same. I don't know.
And so the question that I would kind of raise then is, should we now be expecting generations to last a little bit longer to sort of make up for the fact that the development also takes longer.
Yeah, you can't push a game out after 3 months of development. So, you just can't do it.
You know what I think might actually be going on here? Mm. This is more reckless speculation, but Rockstar has a tendency to release Grand Theft Auto games at the very tail end of a console's lifespan. Mm-hmm. Do you think that this could be the attempt of these financial analysts to encourage Rockstar to release Grand Theft Auto 6
there you go.
In 2018. Double release, Red Dead Redemption 2 and Grand Theft Auto 6.
No, would be my answer.
The time traveling one where you actually get to go back and forth between the old West and modern day.
Right, yeah.
Red Grand Auto Redemption.
Grand Theft Equin.
Believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff.
So I want to throw out a book for you. This is a fiction book, but probably not like any fiction book you've ever read, short of fan fiction. Wait, no, that's not a good thing. NPCs is the title. It's actually written by a guy named Drew Hayes, and it is part one of three in a trilogy. They're all very short. I actually listened to it on audiobook on Audible, and it was narrated by Roger Wayne, and he did a phenomenal job on it, because as you might expect from a book called NPCs, it is about tabletop roleplay. Now, here's the world that he creates. Basically, think of it as Dungeons and Dragons. They didn't use the license, but it's essentially what it is. It's a fantasy roleplay, and there's a group of gamers around the table, and their characters are brought in, and they're going on a new hyper-realistic adventure, according to the module. Mm. And so they do a thing that was ill-advised, let's just say it that way, and it's not even a spoiler to say that their characters die in the first chapter. And they re-roll and they come back in. But while that happens, unknownst to them, but knownst to us, the reader, the NPCs from the tavern where they died take up the mantle, take up the charge, literally take up their loot and the letter from the king, and fearing for their lives because he is a mad king who burns down villages whenever you kill his men, they decide to go on the quest as, let's call them, level zero NPCs. It's brilliant. It's funny. It pokes so much fun at the role player, and it knows what it is.
Sounds a little bit like Red Shirts.
Yes. In different genre, but but yes, it is actually very, that's a great example. So what I really enjoyed about this trilogy, and I've only read the first one, but what I'm enjoying about the trilogy, especially in the way that I listened to it, was the voices. My favorite character is Thistle, and he's a gnome, and so he does the voice like this for Thistle. And then, and then you've got the half-orc, and half-orc is named Grumpf. And Grumpf is not a long-winded character. You know, you say something, he'll like, take the sword. You know, and so it's just wonderful because by the end of it, they end up doing what should be an entirely impossible dungeon. And it just falls into these classic tropes and he plays with it. And you get this sense that in their world, the players, what they call adventurers, have this strange language of their own and this strange culture of their own. And maybe they're being influenced by some other world. This other realm is having influence on them.
How very meta.
I know, it's truly meta. And by the end of it, and I won't spoil it, but by the end of it, what you discover is that this relationship is not unidirectional. That in fact, perhaps they do have more influence on the real world, what we would think of as the real world, than they think. And I got to thinking about this, and I was like, well, that's just kind of silly. And then I realized, no, it isn't. Because, you know, we role play every week in some form or fashion. You know, Chris, you and I are hanging out on Mondays, you know, rolling dice all the time. Mm-hmm. But what we end up doing is when we're away from that table, we talk about those experiences and they sort of inform parts of our lives. And maybe that's a little strong, but the point is this: role play is about, you know, fantasy fulfillment, wish fulfillment, if you will. And I think that there's a strong element there. That's the reason why we game, right? Gaming is wish fulfillment. All media is wish fulfillment. And I think that there's an itch, just a particular itch, that is scratched by this book, NPCs. And give it a try. I think that it's well worth it. It's a short read. Again, I recommend getting it on audiobook if you can. Drew Hayes is a very, very good writer, I think. And in no way at all is it like the fan fiction I implied. It's actually quite good. So NPCs.
And just a quick little plug for my other stuff. I've actually been guest hosting a podcast called Annie Files that a friend of mine has
Little
been,
Orphan been, Annie Files?
No, A-N-I as in anime.
Oh, Anakin. Got it.
Yes. and it's been going on for a little while. I think we joined in on episode like 5 or something like that. But basically there are 4 of us all together who, including the original host of the show. And what we're doing is this, summer 2017 season of anime, we're going through and watching all of the new IP. So we're not doing sequel series. We're not doing spinoffs, anything like that, or some spinoffs, but it's just kind of like new series that have come out this season.
So no Dragon Ball Super.
No. Nothing I'm aware of, sorry. But we haven't gone through all of them yet, so you never know.
So you guys are filtering out the good stuff and the bad stuff.
Yeah, so what we're doing is we're watching the first episode of every new series.
Oh, that's cool.
This season. And basically, we're judging a show by its pilot, effectively. We have this little index that we came up with where we essentially say, based on the first episode, I would watch it. I would give it maybe a couple more episodes to see if I'm interested, but I'm not sure. And then just I dropped it. Like, I'm not going to keep watching based on this first episode. And it might not come as a surprise that most of them are very, very low scores.
What a shock.
Lots of 0%, a few kind of like, you know, maybe like 11% because one of us gave it a maybe or something like that. There are a few, though, that we all sort of kind of agreed unilaterally that we would all keep going, or that most of us would keep going. Maybe one of us was still on the fence. And it's been an interesting exercise to see what it is about a first episode of a show that gets us interested, turns us off.
Well, what's the hook? I mean, are there any interesting hooks in these new shows that you could
a lot of times it's the premise
draws to,
at least for me, this is just
sure,
me.
Sure.
But there's like the premise, if it's interesting enough, and then if they deliver on those ideas, or if they make some good, you know, promises to the viewer, is one of the ways we sort of put it based on, I sort of brought that idea in from, writing excuses. How it is that they set up the story that's to come, it has to really kind of intrigue you. The art usually has to be pretty good because there's a lot of stuff out that is very low budget. But, you know, if the premise is good enough and the writing is good enough, it can make up for some shortcomings in those areas. If the writing is really bad, that's usually a turnoff. And there's a lot of times when it's just kind of like a really dumb idea done really poorly. and there's been a few times, too, where... There's been a premise that, like, you know, a few of us have said we really want to like this show. This whole time we were watching this episode, I wanted to find something in it that would make me want to keep going. And sometimes it would fail you. Yes.
Yeah.
And so it's been a really interesting experience.
Cool. What's the name of the show again?
So it's called
Where Can We Find It?
Annie Files. Okay. And the website you're going to want to go to is the network, if you will, is called Alternative Internet Radio. So the URL is AIRAD.io. So AI Radio. /ANI-files.
And could you don't tell us why, but Chris's hot anime pick of the season, best new show, what is it? Call it now.
My personal pick, or what I think is going to be
your personal pick?
Probably the best one I've seen so far is Welcome to the Ballroom, if I'm getting the title correct. It's a show about this guy who gets into ballroom dancing competitively.
What?
And it's actually pretty good.
Is it based on Baz Luhrmann's Strictly Ballroom, which I know nothing about?
I know even less about it, so I can't say.
Oh, okay. And that's a lie. I totally watched that movie and okay. I liked it.
Okay, that was not the sort of answer that I expected, but okay, good, perfect.
And I thought you were hashtag woke, Jim.
I've hashtag gone back to sleep.
And now, this week's meaty topic of discussion.
Moving into our meaty topic, we're going to talk about games within games and mini games within games, and maybe what is the difference there? Is there a difference? And I think we've already kind of peppered some of that content into our this episode so far. Mm-hmm. I know that there were some mini games you mentioned in Sonic Mania. I also think that there are some mini games, even games within games, inside Yakuza Kiwami. For example, I mentioned Shogi, which, by the way, I don't understand Shogi. I tried to play Shogi. I thought it was just like chess.
It's basically Japanese chess, in a sense.
Yeah, I found out that actually is not true. That's what I thought, because I can play chess. Mm. Actually pretty good at chess, or at least I was once upon a time. Shogi, I don't know what the hell's going on. I'm like, wait a minute, why can't my rook capture this piece? I can move in this direction, why can't I capture the piece? There's all these little rules that are added to Shogi that... I don't get, mainly because I've never played it before. But that being said, that's a full game. Shogi is a game in itself, and it is something that you can play in Yakuza Kiwami. Mm-hmm, you can also play Mahjong. On the other hand, you have what I would consider a mini game, like you can go bowling, or you can go to the batting cages. So maybe that's where we should start. Maybe we should start with, okay, how are we defining a game within a game? What is that? And then also, what is a mini game?
Drawing that line, I think, is going to be tricky because, like, at first I was going to say, like, well, maybe the difference is that, like, you know, there's kind of a game that's self-contained and has its own meta. But you could argue that there's going to be a little bit of a meta for any game, even the smallest of mini games. And then, for example, you know, Shogi has its own meta. It's got its own history. And so you can sort of like play a game of Shogi in this game, and it's kind of its own deal. But then, you know, bowling is also a full-on sport, a full-on game with its own meta. You know, it's different in a lot of ways, naturally. But and then, you know, like the batting cages. That one, I think, is easier to say it's a mini game because it's literally just try to hit the ball. Yeah. And you get points for, like, you know, getting something like a home run or et cetera. But it's not full-on baseball in that case.
Well, let me throw another monkey wrench in here, since we're already having trouble even nailing down what we're talking about, it seems. Consider sports games. Consider modern sports games. In a modern sports game, a lot of the modes you are either playing as a single character, like a My Career mode, or you're playing as like a league, like a team manager where you're managing your team. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, you're also playing actual games of basketball or football or soccer, whatever it may be, whatever sport it is. What part is the game? Is the actual basketball, is the Chicago Bulls playing the Dallas Mavericks, is that a game within a game in that case? Think about it.
That's a good question.
Right? So even is that even a game within a game,
and
Doc?
You heard about the Madden announcement recently. They're intending on doing story mode.
Yes.
Same thing with FIFA.
Well, and plus the NBA 2K 18, if you've heard that, they're having an open world element.
Yeah.
You have your own neighbor. It's called My Neighborhood. You have your own neighborhood where you go and you play before you get drafted, and you can build up your neighborhood. You can play pickup street games. You can go to a barber shop. You can get new shoes. Is that the game within a game, or is that the outside piece and the actual sport itself the game within a game?
Neither one. I think,
or neither one.
I think it's a narrative
or is it all
element.
One game?
I think it's a narrative element.
Yeah.
It's just when you talk about narrative elements, one of the frameworks can be, is it a player-driven narrative or is it a developer-driven mm-hmm. narrative? In this case, I would just say it's an open-ended, player-driven narrative.
Yeah, that wow. I would say it's not a game within a game, because you can look at something, say, for example, like a JRPG, and you go into a battle mode where it's like a totally different layout and all that sort of stuff.
That's a good comparison.
But so the other stuff is just kind of an overarching thing that connects the battles.
Well, I'm glad that you brought up JRPGs, because they also have a history of having mini games. Mm-hmm. And the one I want to talk about, which I did allude to earlier in the show, Blitzball. Mm-hmm. I will go on record one more time and say that Final Fantasy X is a terrible game. It is a bad Japanese RPG, and I'm a big fan of that genre. I think that Final Fantasy X is crap. I think that people that laud it as one of the better Final Fantasies are wrong. And I will go on record saying that. That being said,
send your email to Jim back at
that all being said, though, I like Blitzball. I am an unapologetic Blitzball fan. Mm-hmm. And when I rented Final Fantasy X and played through it, one of the things that I sunk most of my time in was actually Blitzball, and was actually getting more Blitzball players and learning Blitzball techniques and basically just improving myself in that game. That is essentially a sport, but I would consider that a game within a game. So what is the difference there? And I'm not saying that you're wrong with your explanation.
Yeah, sure.
But
sure.
Just so we can follow this thought to its conclusion, mm-hmm. what is the difference there between, okay, this is a sport, basically, mm-hmm. inside a game. So what's the difference here between, say, NBA 2K or Madden, or even a JRPG that has mm-hmm. the outside parts and the battle?
So another famous example of at least mini games, if not games within games, are Mario Party. You've got the overarching board game, and then you've got all the little mini games, and they're all different from one another. You're trying to win in order to advance yourself. Mm-hmm. So perhaps part of it, whichever way we're going with it, is that. Okay, so here, let me take a stab at this. And this is not a fully formed thought. A mini game is a little game that has its own mechanics, its own rules, that somehow is going to give you a little boost or somehow affect the overarching game, the main game. Whereas a game within a game is kind of something that is optional, and a lot of mini games are sometimes optional as well, but a game within a game has its own progression, perhaps. So Blitzball is not necessary to the plot of Final Fantasy X, except when, like, you know, you're playing a little bit at the very beginning.
Blitzball is actually quite plays a large role in the plot of Final Fantasy X.
Does
I have
it?
To
okay.
disagree with you on
okay.
that.
Okay, like, I haven't played
it. The whole thing is that Titus is a Blitzball mm-hmm. player.
So let's then maybe talk about
he has
about
moves
it.
Related to Blitzball. So it is actually related. In fact, the whole first part of the game, and the early thing when you're introduced to him, mm-hmm. is he's this basically sports star in
yeah.
this world.
I remember that, yeah.
yeah.
I think you hit a sore spot there, Chris.
don't diss Blitzball.
I'm not.
Where you just took me right then, mm-hmm. actually, was mm-hmm. Breath of the Wild. Mm. Because you've got those little seeds that you're looking for all over the place, right? Mm-hmm. That's kind of like a game within a game, in the sense that it directly affects. You get to a thing and you're like, okay, there's totally a fairy circle here. There's a little sort of a mini puzzle, if you will.
Right, and you have to solve that puzzle.
I have to solve that puzzle to figure out, you know, what the Korok seed, mm-hmm. And then you go, and oh, there's five statues in a row. The four of them have apples in front of them. What am I supposed to do? You know, and I could, again, I can mm-hmm. see that as like
I whack it with your sword, right?
I wouldn't call that a game within a game. I'd just call that an aspect of the main game.
Well, I would call that a side quest.
Yeah. But I think side quests and games within games are two different things.
I know, I agree. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm saying, though. Mm-hmm. I think that we have... That's where I think we're kind of missing out, is that there are like side quests, and there are games within a game. And I think, for example, when we go to Gwent,
yeah, it's
famous example here, which is a game within a game for sure. Mm-hmm. I mean, we know that. So some of these are, let's look at the ones that we know are games within games to help define it. When it comes to Gwent, it is for me, a game within a game versus a mini game is it a fully formed game that you might enjoy playing completely on its own, mm-hmm. completely divorced from the other parts of the game? Like, for example, in Mario Party, you have all these little mini games that are only fun for like a few moments, and you're really only going to be to be playing those games within the context mm-hmm. of Mario Party.
And however, in a way, those mini games are kind of the randomizer of Mario Party. Sure, you sure. are mm-hmm. using something that's skill-based, granted, but it's basically deciding, as in an RPG, the roll of the dice, do I succeed or fail?
Right.
Do I get points or do I lose them?
Right. So when it comes to Gwent, though, the actual play in the Gwent itself, or the game of Gwent, rather, is a game within a game. But the side quest part of it in Witcher, you actually have a side quest to collect Gwent cards. Mm-hmm. So even there, the lines are blurred somewhat, because you can earn cards, which is one of your side quests. You can earn different cards by playing Gwent. Mm-hmm. Also, you actually can, and I'm trying to remember exactly when this is, but I distinctly remember there were a few times where you needed to play Gwent and you could actually succeed at a side quest
right.
by winning at Gwent.
That's right. There was a whole, let's call it quest chain.
Yes.
About becoming the Gwent master mm-hmm. for the whole world,
right? Essentially. Got to catch them all.
Yeah, I'm kind of reminded of Red Dead, which we were just talking mm-hmm. about, mm-hmm. and how you could play Liar's Dice, or I think it was like blackjack and
right
poker
card
and
games, yeah,
that sort of thing,
yeah.
which totally fit the genre. Mm-hmm. And the fact that you could walk into a tavern, a house of ill repute, if you will, and actually play those kinds of games and bet in-game money, and there were different tables, if you remember. There's the low rollers table and the high rollers table and that kind of a thing.
Was it Sabacc that you could play in KOTOR?
Yes,
yeah.
Sabacc, yes.
Yeah, Sabacc yes. Is one of the in-game games.
Speaking yes. of which, I'm still waiting for someone to make the Star Wars Sabacc standalone card game.
But. You know, it can't be done without doing digital for a couple of reasons. First of all...
I think it would be digital.
I think that's what he's saying. It's just that version of it.
Yeah. Digital. Okay. Like Gwent has a standalone game now. Hearthstone has a standalone
but
game.
But I think...
Sabacc.
Right. But all those two, I mean, that's a good example, the Red Dead Redemption stuff. And I do think those are games within games. But they're all, those to me almost blur the lines, because they're also mini games, right?
Well, but the point is,
because you're playing poker by yourself.
If you're Marston and you're like, I need $1,000,
right?
And I need it fast. I'm going to go in there and I'm going to go to the high rollers table and I'm going to play around and I'm going to throw down my money and I'm going to double my money and I'm going to walk out. And that just feels so right.
I thought you were going to end it with, then you stand up and shoot everyone at the table and take their money. Because that's usually how I end it. But
oh, well, fair enough. But
I'm kind of the black hat.
You get my point.
No, I get your point. And that makes so. And same thing with Blitzball, too. I mean, it served a purpose in Final Fantasy X in terms of it wasn't just you weren't just playing it for Blitzball. It also
it had in-game effects.
There were in-game elements to it. Mm-hmm. In fact, I think it was Titus, but it might have been, I can't remember his name now, the other Blitzball player. But one of them gets like a special move based on if you do well enough in Blitzball, mm-hmm. actually earns a new ability that he can use in battles. So there is some connection there, which of course you would expect because it's still within a main game.
Yeah, yeah.
But I would consider these still games within games. Mm-hmm. Grand Theft Auto obviously is one that we've sort of beat around the bush and not really talked about, but that's probably the one that is most famously associated with these games within games.
There's literally dozens of games you can play.
There's pool. It varies with the games too in the series. But you typically have things like pool or billiards, darts, bowling. They have video games that you can play that are just actual video games that you go into an arcade mm-hmm. and you actually play them. Shenmue did this as well, by the way, and is actually probably the first to do it. Shenmue famously included some actual Sega games within Shenmue. I mean, hell, is there any other more direct example of a game within a game than
Justice
actually taking
Monsters 5?
Yeah, Justice Monsters 5. But see, that was made specifically for Final Fantasy 15. Mm-hmm. In Shenmue, you actually play. It was a Space Harrier. I know was in there, and I think Outrun was too. Right? Do you remember? In Shenmue was it was Outrun.
I haven't played.
Okay. Well, I know Space Harrier was there, and I'm pretty sure Outrun was too. And those are standalone games, standalone arcade games that were actually also, you could play the real versions, the fully complete versions within Shenmue. So those are, that's a,
previously
that is a video
released
game,
games, in
right,
words,
within yeah. a game.
I think I might be coming a little bit closer to a definition then.
Animal Crossing. Animal Crossing had old, remember you could unlock NES games. Like, mm-hmm. You remember that too?
Here's the thing that might be getting a little bit closer to a definition between distinguishing between games within games and mini games. Are they diegetic? That is to say,
that's a $4 word.
That's a $4 word right there. Also diegetic. Yeah, four syllables too.
It's a dollar a syllable. That's how
okay, I gotcha. Cool, yeah. Cool. but going to the arcade machine and playing that arcade game, that's implicitly your character playing
correct.
That game.
Very true.
With Gwent, it is your character playing that card game.
Very
in Blitzball,
true.
It's your character playing Blitzball. Now,
and in Madden, it's your my career character mm-hmm. playing football.
Yeah.
In NBA 2K, it's your my career character mm-hmm. playing basketball. So I don't know. I think you're basically leaning towards that being a game within a game.
Maybe.
I would say that's gamification of a game.
Hmm. Actually,
that's a dirty word. We don't say that here.
But,
I say it. Gamification.
But that being said, you compare that to, say, the Mario Party example of you have like all these little mini games.
Right. Yes.
Those aren't really diegetic. And of course, it's kind of a weird thing because you're playing a board game brought to life.
Right.
Kind
right.
of. But
no, I think you're going in the right direction. I agree with you. Mm-hmm. I see what you're saying. I mean, yeah, those are things that really it's just you're playing these mini games in order to. Advanced, like it's part of the game. The mm-hmm. game is mini games.
Yeah.
So same thing with something like that I was going to bring up too, like WarioWare.
Mm-hmm.
WarioWare is all mini games. That's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Or NES Remix, a game that I think is excellent, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
It's a collection of mini games. You play between 5 and 40 second ish snippets
mm-hmm.
of other NES games. And you have to, you know, basically beat challenges in a very short amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
And you beat a series of challenges to win each one. Are those mini games? Yes, I think it's a collection of mini games, even though you're playing snippets of full games. So I think that might be the difference here. It's like is it a collection of mini games, or are the mini games the way that you're advancing versus mm-hmm. is there a full game outside of it, and then there are some games within it
mm-hmm.
that are, as you say, they're diegetic. Your character is playing those games. And mm-hmm. I think for the most part, that all works, with the one exception being as sports games get bigger and we have my career, and we have these bigger outside elements of you need to figure out, because you do this. I mean, you and I have both played the NBA 2K series, and
mm-hmm.
I don't think Doc is as aware of just how much you can do outside of playing basketball in these games now. But for example, you have a social media account, you have to manage your merchandise line, you have your shoe contracts and all these little things. You go and you have what do you call them? Press conferences after games, where you have to respond to press questions based on your performance.
Mm-hmm.
You have all these little things that you do training.
It's just a simulation.
You have training moments. Oh, it completely is. It's
yeah.
just, I think that it's blurring the lines is kind of the point I'm getting at. I'm not necessarily going to go so far as to, I'm kind of just playing the point out. I don't mm-hmm. really believe that basketball yeah. or football, whatever, is the game within a game. I'm just saying that I'm pointing out that as these games get bigger and start adding elements, including essentially an open world. I mean, it's obviously not a fully open world, but it's getting closer in NBA 2K that mm-hmm. what they're doing with NBA 2K is I think, pretty interesting. It is pretty exciting. It may be something that some players may not want. They may just want the basketball sim, but adding these elements does kind of blur that line between, okay, what am I doing here? Is this a basketball game? Am I playing a simulation of basketball, or is it about I'm playing a basketball player and I'm playing his life as a basketball player, which includes playing games, but it includes other things too.
It's RPG.
Exactly. It's RPG. Like we talked about yeah. last week, where it was RPGs, or a couple weeks ago, RPGs creeping into every genre.
Yeah. Yeah. Honestly, what I just heard you say is that these new sports games are basically just Persona.
They're JRPGs, but with basketball games instead of battles.
Yeah, there you go.
I mean, I wouldn't include the J part, but I do think that there are RPGs. You've played them. You have stats.
Yeah.
You start out at like, you know, maybe a 60 overall.
Yeah, your character
grows. Yeah, and as your character gets, you shoot more baskets, you start getting better at shooting. You know, you start hitting better three pointers, your 3-point shot percentage can go up. As you level up, you can actually put points into different stats. You can improve your physical abilities, mm-hmm. your strength, your agility. So yeah, it's creeping in everywhere, but and it is also arguably a game with, I mean, this, I wouldn't call it a game within a game, but it mm-hmm. is adding extra pieces to it, much more so than, say, you know, back in the day when you used to play, say, NBA Live mm-hmm. on your Super Nintendo or your Genesis. It wasn't like that.
You start a game.
You start you play a game, through it, you and pick then a done. Player, yeah. and maybe you, even if you can create your own player, you're still just playing basketball. There's mm-hmm. none of this other element to it.
Yeah. And the other thing that where it gets a little bit tricky, too, is... because I think I'm with Doc, and I think you're basically agreeing, Jim, that the career mode is more just kind of a container for a game rather than being a game within a game.
Yeah, I'm not. I'm really more playing the devil's advocate role here.
But where things do get tricky is in those same career modes. There's usually some sort of like drill you can do, or some sort of like little, like you know, maybe a training exercise or something like that.
There's actually a lot of them, is what I'm saying. There's a ton of them now.
Now, like even more. Then you get a little bit weird because are those mini games or are those games within games?
Those are mini games
because they're diegetic.
Yeah.
So my character is trained diegetic here. Is not,
yeah, I don't. That's why I'm saying the whole issue of okay, is it diegetic? I think is a step in the right direction, but I don't think it fits.
It's
it,
not the
it
only
takes
thing.
Every box.
Yeah,
because you're right. When you're doing something like, I mean, same thing with look at Grand Theft Auto. Mm-hmm. You can go to the gym in San Andreas, and if you want to get stronger, you can lift weights. But in order to do so, there's a mini game.
Mm-hmm, that's right.
Like you have to hit, you know, like you have to alternate between, you know, X and square multiple times in order to like bench press or something like that. So there's little mini games to do it. Remember that? But I mean, but that's diegetic. Your character is lifting weights, but it also serves a mechanical purpose. So maybe that's part of it too. Does it? Cause like your example of the training, in the NBA games, that also is serving a mechanical purpose. Yeah. You're improving your stats. Yeah. So maybe that's the difference. Whereas something like say poker, in Red Dead Redemption, there's no stat that you're improving there.
No.
Your character's just playing poker. Or like in Shenmue, when you're playing Space Harrier, you're just playing Space Harrier. If you want to get better,
player ability matters there. Yeah.
If you want to get better, you as a player have to get better. There is no stat that's being improved. So perhaps it's both a combination of diegetic, but also it's something that you're doing that isn't improving your stats. It's not something that is like, I'm doing this for a purpose outside of the game.
I'll tell you where the border zone exists for me. It's actually in BioShock with the hacking minigame. And I'm going to go out there on the limb and say that it's a minigame. It's basically Pipe Dream. Mm-hmm. I had Pipe Dream for my original Game Boy, and I loved that game. It was one of my favorite games ever. And they took Pipe Dream, and they just inserted it as a little minigame. Now, by the time you get to the last levels, you are so sick of playing this pipe hacking minigame in BioShock that... they actually took it out for two, and it ended up being, I'm going to call it a quick time event. It wasn't hit X not to die, but it kind of was, in that it was this little, almost like metronome kind of thing that went back and forth. And the harder ones had, like a narrower thing you were trying to hit, and it was faster, you know, and all these other things. And if you got it in the green zone, you got good stuff. And if you got it in the yellow zone, you didn't get good stuff, but you hacked it, and if it was in the red zone, bad things happened, and it immediately triggered the alarm. It was kind of the same thing with the pipe mini game. Or you could just develop a bunch of auto hacks, and you walk up to things, auto hack. And a lot of people chose to go that path. So one of the things I really liked about that implementation was you could choose to blow it up, you could choose to hack it, you could choose to auto hack it, moving on. And in order to actually hack it, you had to do a clever thing that required player ability. And to me, that connection between there's a tense moment and you're going to have to actually perform a task, I liked. So to me, that connection of this is a meaningful mini game in context was okay with the conceit of, okay, you're going to pause time now. And because that's what happens. You can have a big daddy behind you really ticked off, but you can pause time for 90 seconds while you play the mini game.
Yeah. And so, again, this is kind of going back a little bit to my my dice roll analogy, is because we've sort of shown, for example, in The Witcher and other things, Red Dead, that these games within games can be affected by and can affect the main game. If for no other reason than like you get the ability to finish quests, you can get money from it, which isn't necessarily building your character, but it does affect your character. It's improving your ability to take on the game. But then, like, the example of the auto hacking or doing the drills or the exercises in these sports games, those are kind of like more elaborate button pushes, so to speak. It's I am moving away for just a second to decide a thing. If I have enough skill to, you know, play this little game, which has its own like kind of defined space, defined rules, fail state, success state. So it has all the trappings or all the makings of a game by the strictest definition. If I succeed at that, then I succeed at the action. And then that allows me to advance in the game. Because I like with that action having been a success, if that makes sense.
Right.
Whereas even if you have these side quests for games within games, they're kind of standalone enough that you're not really most of the time going to decide whether or not you can advance in the game or whether you're going to have improved in the game meaningfully by having played poker, for example, except for like that money thing again. Or like, you know, Jim, you finish the game and you shoot everyone around the table and take their money. But
that's usually what I do when I lose. Mm-hmm. So like if I'm winning, I'll just keep playing. But then if I lose, then I just shoot them and I take the money anyway. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a no matter what I win scenario. Mm-hmm. But it's the old West. I mean, that's how it was done back then.
Mm-hmm.
I'm role playing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a sore loser, Chris.
Yeah. Yeah, and I don't know, like the thing that's kind of striking me too is that it might not be that there is really a difference between a mini game and a game within a game, except maybe our perception of it as being like, you know, we have Gwent as a standalone game now.
Right.
I think it's just how much
we thought of it as a game within a game though before that was even the case.
Yes, we did. But I mean it's I think it's like the meat. How much meat is there? Mm-hmm. Is a big part of it.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah.
So how much meat is there? So if all you're doing is like lifting weights in San Andreas, if I'm just clicking two buttons back and
forth,
it's
a quick time
to lift a weight. Yeah, I mean it's not really, you're not really timing it,
mm-hmm.
but yeah, I mean it's just you're just tapping buttons really quickly. Yeah. It's a mini game.
In game activity might be another.
Yeah, sure. It's a challenge with a slight mechanical shift.
Yeah,
right. But then you have something like you know, Gwent, that is a full game.
Mm-hmm.
Blitzball is arguably a full game. There's a lot there. I don't know if we necessarily need to have the cutoff be related to, you know, could it sell individually or could it be marketed individually?
Yeah.
Because I think that's kind of that's more of a marketing thing. Mm-hmm. That doesn't necessarily mean much.
Mm-hmm. So maybe here's another thought. Going back to the diegetic thing, is it seen as a game in the fiction of the game? So a lot of these mini games are often just kind of like it's our way of interfacing with something that's determining whether or not, say, I hack the deal.
Right.
But the person doing the hacking isn't looking at that as a game. They might be sort of comparing it to a game like, oh, this is like I'm thinking of it as if I were thinking about a game. But to them, it is the mechanical way in which they're hacking into that thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like I'm not actually lifting. CJ isn't lifting that bar,
mm-hmm.
by clicking X and square back, yeah, and forth.
Exactly.
He's using his arms to push it up.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So I see what you're saying here. Yeah.
By the same argument, when you run down the street, especially in that iteration, it was better to hit like circle, 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 circle instead of hold it down, because then your stamina, it was a sort of a hack.
Well, there I think we're just, yeah, there I think we're just getting into the game mechanics themselves.
Yeah, and that's my point, is that the game mechanic for lifting weights was simply that.
Yeah.
The fact that it told you that up on the screen was a convention of you're not going to do this very often. You need these up on the screen
right now.
It would be my argument.
That makes sense. And yeah. I think that's probably that probably makes the most sense of it. Yeah. But so we've kind of talked about the subject, and kind of what I'd like to do before we close, because I think we've kind of come full circle with the talk,
mm-hmm.
is maybe just mention a few mini games that we've enjoyed a lot in other games, aside from a few that we've talked about.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to throw out, obviously I've already mentioned Blitzball, so I won't talk about it more.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Gwent. I don't think we need to talk about Gwent anymore, but outside of those two, what other ones, I'll start with you, Chris, mm-hmm. can you identify that you think are,
so I mentioned briefly during the Sonic Mania talk earlier that they brought back that one mini game from Sonic 3 where you would try to get the Chaos Emeralds by converting all the blue balls to red balls without hitting any red balls. And they actually added a new one in Sonic Mania that kind of has this sort of like a pseudo 3D thing going on where you're trying to catch a UFO that's carrying an emerald. And what you do is you extend your time because you have a time limit by collecting rings. Mm-hmm. But then you collect these blue orbs to increase your speed. And there you kind of go from Mach 1 to Mach 2 and then up to Mach 3 in order to make it easier for you to catch up to the thing before the time limit. And so that's kind of a cool little mini game there. It's a lot of fun to play. Also very challenging.
Cool. And what about a game within a game? Do you have one of those?
Game within a game. So there was there's this one game that I played a long, long time ago. You guys ever heard of Spy Fox?
No.
It was from Humongous Entertainment, like sort of kids game. It was actually probably one of my first exposures to the point and click adventure genre.
Okay.
Just kind of made for kids. There was this one little game you could play in one of them where I think he was playing it on his watch maybe or something like that. And it was like this game where you're kind of on this ocean. And you can be a speedboat on the surface. If you went up, you turned into a little plane. And if you went underwater, you turned into a sub. And you're trying to sort of dodge enemies and try to get the high scores by surviving for a long time. I forget if there were collectibles or not. But that was always really cool just because I really liked the premise. And it was kind of a neat little self-contained thing that didn't matter at all in the course of the game.
Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of fun. And the other one that sort of comes to mind, I'm sure there are many, many more that I'm forgetting. But... in Splatoon, the first one, when you were in a lobby waiting for a game to start, you could play this little game where you have this like squid and you can charge up a jump and you try to land on a platform and you keep just trying to go up as high as you can. It gets more difficult each level. You're just sort of seeing how far you can get in the time that it takes for you to load into a game. So that was kind of cool.
Cool. So one I'd like to mention, and this is going to be kind of maybe a little bit more obscure, but... There's two versions of this mini game. In the old Space Quest series, which is a series of adventure games from the 90s, comedy adventure series that I enjoyed quite a bit. And one of the things that they did was in Space Quest 3, and then again in Space Quest 4, they had a few later too. They had an arcade that you could go to, and you could play one of the games. And one of the games in Space Quest 3 was Astro Chicken. And which is essentially you are a chicken that is a very simple game that you are flying through the air and you're like laying eggs to sort of attack the enemies or whatever on the ground. And it's just a simple game, but it had multiple levels. You can get high scores and all that. And then in Space Quest 4, they had the same game, only it was like a newer version that worked a little bit differently called Ms. Astro Chicken. kind of like a Pac-Man, Ms.
Yeah.
Pac-Man
yeah,
sort
yeah.
of thing. And I remember actually enjoying those games more than maybe I care to admit.
That's
what they were pretty fun, but they were just very simple arcade style games that were just basically ported over and made into a more, you know, a parody of those games versions inside Space Quest. So I want to mention those mm-hmm. as games within games that kind of stand out a little bit.
Yeah.
And then for you know, mini game, for me, it's probably more because I tend to not like. Typically, a lot of mini games to me are annoying.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that I do like, because it feels like a departure from the game itself, when to be honest with you. So I guess the ones that I like for the actual mini games would be when games that are essentially a collection of mini games.
Right, yeah, like the Mario Parties, the WarioWares.
Yeah, like yeah. NES Remix is the big one for
mm-hmm.
me. Mm-hmm. I loved, in particular, the ones where you had to play short snippets of very famous NES games, but with different characters.
Mm-hmm.
I love the remix aspect.
There's always some little twist, yeah.
Right. So like playing Donkey Kong as Link,
mm-hmm.
where you can't jump, so now makes it quite a bit harder,
ladders, yeah.
for example. So that would be my two choices. Mm-hmm. Doc, do you have any good ones to mention?
Well, yeah, we haven't actually talked about Geometry Wars, which was, of course, originally in Project Gotham Racing 2. I never played it.
Right. I had totally forgotten about that,
yeah.
but I have played Geometry Wars.
Yeah.
I totally forgot it was in... Originally,
it was like the best-selling Xbox Live arcade game ever of all time, period. And so I played it at that point, and I enjoyed it. But I never actually played it in game. But I thought I'd give that a shout out as a game I enjoyed very much. Honestly, if I had to pick one that I personally spent the most time on and enjoying, aside from Gwent, it would actually be Liar's Dice. It would be the games from Red Dead, that whole set.
Mm-hmm.
I spent probably half of the time that I played that game doing that and earning money and doing the gambling and poker elements.
Yeah.
I loved like whenever they came out with the sort of the poker night at the inventory type games, if you remember that, and they had the characters and that kind of a thing, which isn't a game within a game. It just is a framework around the game of a fictional meta. But at the same time, that kind of a piece inside of Red Dead was fun, especially with the zombies. I actually hated that expansion, but then because you could play poker with zombies, because you know that's fun. But I'm gonna go out on a limb, and I'm gonna say that my all time favorite mini game or game within a game, if you will, Ocarina of Time fishing. I played 100 hours or so as a kid, as a rather old kid, trying to get that stupid big fish.
Twilight Princess actually had a pretty good fishing mini game too.
Yeah,
I remember playing that one quite a bit. Mm-hmm.
But there's one fish in the pond, and he's the biggest fish, and he beats all the records.
Mm-hmm. I think that's one thing that I think we miss talking about just generally, fishing as a common mini game in a lot of games.
Yeah, it was in Final Fantasy 15, and I enjoyed it in that.
It's been in a lot of games, and I think that's kind of one that we sort of forgot a little bit about, but okay.
Oh, I didn't forget it. I saved it.
You saved it.
Cherry, the fish flavored cherry on top of our gaming sundae.
Delicious.
Cool. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for episode 109 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast, our discussion on games within games and on mini games. And just as a reminder for you, we are trying to expand our audience a little bit. So we'd appreciate if you guys could look us up on Twitter and Facebook and share us with your friends if you think they might be interested in the show. You can find us on Twitter @BackwardCompat. You can also find us on Facebook/BackwardCompat. We also encourage you to write in to inbox@backward-compatible.com if you have anything you'd like us to talk about, if you'd like to perhaps rebut or to respond in some way to anything that we talk about on the show, or if there's something we haven't mentioned that you'd just like to hear about or share with us. And another way you can help us to grow the show a little bit is to give us a 5-star review on iTunes. Each one of those makes it more likely that we'll show up in searches. So there are lots of ways you can help us out in expanding the show. We are ad-free. We don't have a budget. So we're counting on you, our loyal listeners, to help us spread the word.
Do that. Do what Chris said.
Cool. Well, thank you again for joining us, everyone. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
I'm Doc.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to write into the show because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox@backward-compatible.com. And we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.
Backward compatible. Let's see. Okay, so next we have Doc to talk about Gwent.
Get wrecked.
Got this part out, whoever is editing this. This part right here.
That would be me.
Begin once I stop talking.
Hello, me in the future.
No, just leave all this in. This is what the people want.